Well, it's a familiar story about corruption and whistleblowers who pointed out and then having the government come after them, threatening them, firing them, taking other measures. And we've got someone with us tonight that is a whistleblower at the World Bank. She's talking about the corruption that she saw there and how it went ignored and unaddressed. And now she is actually being attacked by Eric Holder in the Department of Justice for something that is not really even in their jurisdiction. Now, a lot of our viewers are familiar with the Federal Reserve, but they may not be familiar with the World Bank. So just to catch you up a little bit on that, the World Bank was created in 1944, and the principal stakeholders in that were the United States and the UK. Now, in the first years of the World Bank, from 44 to 68, it was mostly financing income-producing infrastructure in countries. Then in 68 to 80, there was a change. At that point, Robert McNamara became the head of the World Bank. He was appointed by LBJ at the end of that administration. And instead of financing mostly income-producing infrastructure, they started financing social services. And as a result, third world debt soared, increasing at an average annual rate of 20% a year. And then the next phase we see is the World Bank coming in and offering loans to these same third world banks that have been impoverished in debt. We see them coming in and offering to service that debt for them. Now, the lady that we're going to be talking to is Karen Hughes. She worked at the World Bank in the legal department for 20 years. And she saw some questionable loan practices there. She brought those up. She was transferred. Then she was fired. And subsequent appeals went unheeded by the World Bank and often by areas of the federal government. We're going to talk to her about that right now. Well, welcome, Karen. Thank you for talking to InfoWars. It's always an honor to talk to somebody who is a whistleblower out of a concern for integrity and to see that the right thing is done. And your personal story, I think, is as important as what has happened with the AP reporters or with the IRS scandals, because we see the same sort of thing happening where somebody sees something that's wrong, or they're investigating something that may be wrong or an embarrassment to the government. And instead of correcting the problem, of course, the government comes after them. And so that's essentially what they've done with you. Tell us a little bit about your background there at the World Bank and what you were doing prior to the discovery of corruption there.
I was a lawyer in the World Bank legal department, and I was just doing my job as a lawyer in the institution. And so when they started to retaliate, and the retaliation was very specific and very direct. I was put on probation twice. It was an attempt to intimidate me. And at a certain point, it was an attempt to make an example out of me to make sure that other people who were also seeing corruption wouldn't report that either.
And let's talk about that corruption that you saw. You actually saw some corruption involving a loan to the Philippines government. Is that correct?
Yes. As a matter of fact, the president of the Philippines, Joseph Estrada, was impeached, and he had to pay back millions of dollars that he had stolen from the Philippines people.
And actually, I think at the heart of this, there was a default with a major bank there that I believe was around $900 million that went back on the taxpayers of the Philippines. Is that correct?
Well, it was $500 million. In terms of the bailout, because the people who had their money on deposit in Philippines National Bank got nervous. What had happened was the man who owned Philippine Airline, Lucio Tan, was a borrower in default. And he bought the shares of the Philippine National Bank, and the depositors didn't want to have their money on deposit in a bank which was managed by a borrower in default. And so they took their money out, and the Philippine Deposit Insurance Corporation had to bail out the bank for $500 million. And then the World Bank had $200 million of a loan that had to be canceled because the government didn't comply with the conditions. And then there was matching financing from Japan, and that also got canceled. Now, so it added up to $900 million.
You saw this coming up, and you blew the whistle on that. You said, this doesn't meet our standards of loans. Is that correct?
Yes, I wrote a letter that I wanted the World Bank to give to the government of the Philippines, warning them that we would not be able to disperse the loan because the conditions weren't being met. The conditions, there were two conditions that weren't being met. One was they were supposed to strengthen their banking supervision, and it's certainly not banking supervision when a borrower in default buys the bank. Yeah, they were supposed to change their legislation. And the other condition was that Philippines National Bank was supposed to be privatized. And when you're selling shares, employee shares, to a borrower in default, that is not privatizing. What now, happened was there weren't enough shares left.
Now, when you saw this, you reported this to the World Bank Audit Committee, the audit committee of the World Bank, right? And then 2 days later, they fired you?
What happened was I went to see Jim Wolfensohn, who was the president of the World Bank at the time, together with the man who represented the Dutch government. And we said that there was this problem in the legal department that I was getting reassigned when I was doing my job. And Jim Wolfensohn said he would handle it. And his way of handling it was to give the problem, to tell my boss that I'd been up to complain about him. And so then I went to the Treasury Department, and I told the Treasury Department that if the U.S. management was not going to play by the rules, that the other countries in the World Bank were going to make sure that we wouldn't automatically appoint the president of the World Bank. For the first 66 years, the World Bank was created in 1944, mm-hmm. and for the first 66 years, the U.S. could just name whoever they wanted to as the president.
Because the U.S. is a major shareholder in the World Bank, is that correct?
We were, 16%, but when the World Bank was set up, we were one of the two countries that set it up. The U.K. was the other country, and then 44 countries came to a place in New Hampshire called Bretton Woods. That's why the World Bank and the IMF are called the Bretton Woods institutions.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Now, you continued to, even though they reassigned you and then subsequently fired you, you continued to push this, and you sent it to the, took it to the Senate, is that correct? Also to the
Congress.
That's
right. I went to the Senate Committee on Foreign Relations, and I told, that was then chaired by Joe Biden, and Hillary Clinton and Barack Obama were senators on that committee. And I warned them that we were going to lose the ability to appoint the president of the World Bank, that there was corruption going on, that when people inside the World Bank cannot report that there are accounting problems, which is what that is, there was a cover-up to the board. And you can't have a cover-up to the board in a bank because money goes the wrong way.
Mm-hmm. Now, when they came out of this, the Senate sent letters to the World Bank. And they essentially ignored that, right, as well as firing someone else, a lawyer for the staff association.
Oh, they fired a whole slew of people, and it wasn't just letters. They also commissioned a government accountability audit because this was major, major corruption.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, wasn't there legislation also passed by Congress?
There is legislation in effect now. The World Bank came to Congress and asked for some money. And Congress said, not as long as the GAO audit is not going forward and you're firing whistleblowers.
Mm-hmm.
We have to do some oversight here. We have to be serious about this. And they also took very much to heart the warning that I had given them, which was that the U.S. had lost its credibility with 188 ministers of finance.
Now, Paul,
this is not a good thing.
Right. Now, Paul Volcker, former head of the Fed, also got involved, didn't he? And wasn't his involvement to essentially say, move along, there's nothing to see here?
Yes. What happened was the Dutch government asked for the audit committee to get involved, and Pierre Duquesne, who was the chairman of the audit committee, commissioned Paul Volcker to come in and look at this corruption. And what happened was there's something called the Institutional Integrity Department that's supposedly there to fight corruption. What that group does is it serves as a goon squad to intimidate any staff member that's going to report that there's a fraud. This is a terrible problem.
So
there were 16 staff members who were members of the Institutional Integrity Department that tried to tell Paul Volcker what was going on, and they got retaliated against, and they ended up with being compensated for how they were being retaliated against.
So we have this major financial institution that we've got a major stake in, as the U.S. citizens do, the taxpayers do, and they're doing questionable loan procedures of hundreds of millions of dollars, billions in many cases. And whenever there's corruption and people blow the whistle on it, they're getting fired. Congress is sending them letters saying that they can't retaliate against people. They're ignoring that. And yet the mainstream media didn't pick up on this at all.
It gets worse. It gets worse. The World Bank issues bonds, $180 billion worth of bonds. And the financial statements of the World Bank are not credible when you have this kind of retaliation against lawyers and accountants. So I went to the SEC, and I didn't get anywhere. I said, there's been the audit committee has commissioned an external audit of the controls, and that auditor, that was KPMG, didn't follow the audit standards. I said, so the United States is not credible. And there's something called the National Advisory Council, which has the chairman of the Fed on it. It's chaired by the Treasury Department. And I reported, I wrote them many times. And I said, you know, the United States is losing its financial integrity and credibility. And the dollar is going to be not a credible instrument. And the U.S. credit rating is going to be a problem.
Absolutely.
And what I ultimately documented is something very, very serious, which is called state capture. Because if the SEC is not regulating the market, then why should anybody invest in the security market? And so what bothered me was the serious nature of the charges and the fact that the media wasn't covering it.
Absolutely.
And I later found out what the problem was, and that is that our media is absolutely dominated by these crooks.
Absolutely, yeah. That's something that we've been talking about for quite some time. And everybody is starting to come to the same conclusion, seeing the same thing. Here you've got a situation where, to recap it for the viewers, you've got hundreds of billions of dollars in bonds. You've got questionable loans being made. Anytime anybody questions that or brings it up or points it out, they're fired or retaliated against. You've got Congress saying, don't do that. This is much, much bigger than the bank scandals and bank failures that we had in 2008, yet there's total silence from the mainstream media. You listed in your article, you talked about the different organizations that passed on this story. New York Times, Washington Post, Wall Street Journal, NPR, Forbes, the Broadcasting Board of Governors, the National Press Club. Basically, nobody in the mainstream media picked that up, and you now know why. Tell the audience why.
Okay, there's a very accurate analysis of the markets, which was done by the, it's a university in Switzerland, which is known as the best university in Europe. It's called the Federal Institute of Technology. What they did was they got very accurate data on who owns all of the 40,000 transnational companies. And they did mathematical modeling, systems modeling, and they found out that when we think that there are 10 banks, guess what? With interlocking corporate directorates, they are one conglomerate entity.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Exactly. So we have got, what have we got? We've got a dominant super entity that has 40% of the companies on the stock markets and 60% of their earnings. Now, they don't have that much money. I mean, they have a lot of money, but not that much. It's just the clever way that they have made their investments through the interlocking directorates.
And you point out that at the core of all this, the heart of all this, is really the Federal Reserve.
Well, it is the entities that own the Federal Reserve and the central banks in the other countries.
Mm-hmm, right. And the clearinghouse, essentially, for all this is, as Carol Quigley pointed out, and you quote this in the article, or at least it's in the New American, I'm not sure if it's a quote from them or from you, but you said that this club of private central bankers, the Bank for International Settlements that's in Switzerland, that is a private bank that is owned and controlled by the world's central banks, which are themselves private banks.
Yes, it's all that same ball of wax.
Right. And so essentially these people also, as they have the largest ownership, I think it was 47% of the world's stocks and 60% of the profits, and they own this consolidated media environment that we find ourselves in, where it's consolidated down now to just five different institutions that own pretty much all the mainstream media in the U.S. But let's go back just briefly to your whistleblower story, because after this story got no traction whatsoever in the press, you continued to press this. You continued to try to get justice done. You sued them. You bought a bond so that you would have standing, and then you sued the World Bank. Tell us about that.
Okay, but let me say, first of all, that I was not acting alone. There is a very active group of World Bank whistleblowers.
Mm-hmm.
Just think of a dream team where one person's good at one thing and one person's good at something else. I was their lawyer, not formally. We're sort of an informal group. But I testified in the UK Parliament twice because there's a UK whistleblower All right. I went to a conference in India because there's an Indian whistleblower. And, you know, we would all figure out who was situated at what point to do what.
And
we stuck with it.
That's great. Yeah, we should get some of those people on the show as well. Now,
definitely.
Tell us about this lawsuit that you filed and what happened to that.
Okay. It was really fun, actually. I'm not a litigator, but that's what I did. I bought a bond and I sued KPMG, which was the auditing firm that didn't follow the audit standards. And one of the things, by the way, that I picked up in this is that the accountants should not be policing themselves, and neither should the lawyers. Because there were any number of times that if these self-policing entities had been ethical, the problem would have righted itself. So everybody that thinks we've got people watching out for us, no, we don't. That was what I discovered in my lawsuit. And one of the things that happened, for example, was there was a filing deadline. I went the night before, midnight before the filing deadline, and I read the brief one more time. Somebody had hacked my computer. Huh. It was gone. And I later went and I complained about it to the FBI. That's illegal.
They you might can't have been the ones who did it.
Yeah.
The FBI might have been the ones who did it.
So Eric Holder, cutting fast forward, Eric Holder is dragging me into court on bogus charges now. That's where the FBI reports. They report to him.
Well, and let's talk about that. Because we didn't mention this either, but the UK has a serious fraud office. They had asked the Securities and Exchange Commission, the SEC here in the U.S., for information about this. The SEC just ignored that. You also appealed to the Inspector General of the Treasury Department back in 2010. Now, that's familiar to a lot of people who are looking at the IRS scandal. That's the Inspector General's Office of the Treasury Department investigating the IRS, and basically they didn't do anything about it. But what's interesting about your arrest and the legal issues involved here is that you had the Board of Directors and the Board of Governors gave you a pass to attend their meeting. Is that correct?
Not only that, they settled my lawsuit. And the clerk in the Court of Appeals just ignored 188 ministers of finance. They didn't like that, believe me. And I have been writing the embassies of all of these countries. They're all aware, very well aware. And a lot of them are saying, Karen, why aren't you getting through to the American people? And I didn't know why I wasn't getting through. It's because of this media problem that we have here. And right. What I'm talking about, state capture.
Now, the Board of Directors gives you a pass to come to the meeting. But the U.S. Secret Service tells you you can't come. And I find that very interesting that U.S. Secret Service would get involved in this. When they don't really have a standing in this, there's 188 members, member nations, and you've got a board of directors that extends an invitation to you, and then the U.S. Secret Service says you can't come. You emailed your invitation to them, but they disregarded that, the police commissioner, and they arrested you when you showed up there. Is that correct?
Yes, but don't forget, I'm a lawyer. So I didn't just email the Secret Service. I cleared my email first with all 188 ministers of finance. I said, this is the letter that I am sending to the director of the Secret Service saying that my case was settled, saying that I have a valid pass. And then I sent the letter. And then when I showed up and they wouldn't let me in, what they did was they went to a flunky in the World Bank. And they had the flunky sign a piece of paper saying, you are barred from coming in. I said, with all due respect, this flunky cannot overrule 188 ministers of finance. Yeah. This piece of paper is invalid. Yeah. And then when I went back to the World Bank the following week, what I did was I sent a whole bunch of correspondence and I was copying all of the officials on the board of the World Bank and also the Board of Governors, saying, if you have any doubt whether this barring notice is legal, just ask these guys whether they settled my lawsuit. And so then when I showed up and I was arrested, I was practically apoplectic. They put me in handcuffs. They put me in a car right in front of the World Bank as a spectacle, and they left me there for an hour, and I have a bionic elbow. I broke my elbow, and so it wasn't very comfortable to have these handcuffs with my, arms behind behind my back.
Yeah, it's not comfortable to be handcuffed even if you don't have something wrong.
Actually, you know, the story's really cute. There were two police officers when I was arrested. And the first one said, okay, if you think that you're legally in the World Bank, then why don't you go back and discuss this with Commissioner Michael Reese? And so I was walking out of the building, you know, I was going to go and discuss this. And the second guy is the one that arrested me. So then when I was in the cop car, I said to Officer Lee, I said, Officer Lee, you don't want to be in the middle of this. Why don't you have the guy who's arresting me be the one with his name on the arrest? So she did that.
Wow. I find it amazing that they would get the Secret Service involved in this. And then what's happening now, you've got a court date coming up on the 30th.
That's right.
Eric Holder is getting involved in this. This is not a federal crime, unlawful entry, and yet they're literally making a federal case out of it. I find it amazing what links they'll go to try to shut you up.
Well, they thought they would intimidate me, but I don't work that way. I was captain of the NYU fencing team. I'm just looking to see what foot they're on. And so don't forget this citation to appear in court. By the way, if they don't call this thing off, I'd like some company there. It's on the 30th. And it's at 10 o'clock, and I'm in courtroom C10 of the Superior Court of the District of Columbia Criminal Division. And my charge is that I have violated the D.C. statute. So I've been in touch with the general counsel of the District of Columbia Council, and I've given him all the documents. And I've said, you know, this is kind of bad lawyering if the person who has signed this notice doesn't have authority. Why don't you get involved here? And he said, well, I don't think it really is anything that involves me. I said, you know, this is a corrupt business environment, and maybe the World Bank and DC's biggest employer ought to take notice that they're working in an environment riddled with corruption. This is corruption.
Oh, absolutely. Well, we have the District of Columbia ignoring a Supreme Court ruling for 5 years about firearms and the Second Amendment. So it doesn't really surprise us in that regard. Let's move on to the corruption that you saw there. Now, you made a lot of statements about how the global financial system is dominated by a small group of corrupt, power-hungry figures centered around the privately owned Federal Reserve. Tell us what you saw there firsthand that convinced you of that.
Well, just think of this project in the Philippines that I'm working on, where the president of the Philippines is corrupt. By the way, the government of the Philippines at the time, I was working on judicial reform with the Chief Justice, Hilario Davide, who wrote the Constitution in the Philippines, was a fabulous man, was trying to clean up his government. So if the World Bank is not helping him by having the lawyer reassigned, that is corruption of a huge scale. Just think about it, millions and millions of dollars that ought to go to fight corruption in the Philippines is going to line Estrada's pocket. And the government actually, when they, after they impeached him, they tried him and they took back the corruption. They repossessed a lot of the things that he had put the corrupt money in. So this is clearly showing the corruption. Now, the other whistleblowers that I'm talking about, these are people that were reporting accounting violations where money that was supposed to go one place went another place. And when they reported it, they were retaliated against. And when you have that, what that does is that provides a disincentive for other people that see money going the wrong way.
Yeah, yeah. Well, it's not
and there
just...
Was, yeah, I was just going to say something about the Institutional Integrity Department. Mm-hmm. This is a group that acted like a goon squad. Hmm. They weren't investigating corruption. They were investigating people who were trying to prevent corruption.
Well, it doesn't really surprise us, I guess, when we see things like going on in the European Union where they put technocrats in charge and essentially suspend elections in countries because of debt that they owe, that they've now, you know, first the banks fail out of corruption and questionable accounting practices. They put that debt on the public and then they say, you owe us so much money, we're now going to take over your government. I mean, we're seeing not only corruption, but we're seeing subversion on a wide scale of the sovereignty of nations. Some of the most outspoken critics of this have been the UK Independence Party, UKIP, Nigel Farage, and the European Union. And now we see that there's an article that just broke in The Guardian. It says that the EU exit would put US trade deal at risk Britain is warned, by the Obama administration. What they're threatening to do is they're essentially blackmailing the United Kingdom to stay in the EU, saying that they're going to take away this deal that encompasses half of the world's GDP and a third of its trade. They're essentially blackmailing the UK with the paper money that the Fed is printing, because we've been off of the gold standard for quite some time, and you've got a lot to say about the gold standard as well.
That's right.
Tell us a little bit about that.
All right. Well, let's look first at this Inspector General's report that the Treasury Department gave to the Germans when the Germans asked to see their gold. Mm-hmm. The Germans didn't like to get a paper audit when all they wanted to do was to see their gold, which was in storage in the Federal Reserve.
And that was just back in January.
That's right. So the Germans asked for their gold back. Now this, and what the Germans were told was, you can have it maybe in 7 years. Now this is an act of war.
Right.
This is an act of war. This is extremely serious.
Yeah, a lot of nations, as the viewers may or may not know, a lot of nations turned their gold over to the U.S. for safekeeping after World War II. And supposedly it's in Fort Knox, but even though a lot of congressmen have asked to see it, even though the Germans have demanded its return, the U.S. isn't showing anybody. They're not showing us their cars and they're not showing us the gold. And so a lot of people have suggested that perhaps it's not there.
Well, what this gets back to is the credibility of the Treasury Department.
Right.
The Treasury Department was supposed to give a report on the World Bank for the World Bank to qualify for the U.S. capital increase. The Treasury Department was supposed to say whether or not there was substantial improvement in overcoming the retaliation against whistleblowers. So in November, Secretary Geithner lied to Congress. So I went to each of the members of the Appropriations Committees, and I told them what was really happening, as opposed to what Secretary Geithner had said. So when you have this level of lack of credibility, how can the Germans accept the Treasury Department's word for that their gold is there? Their word is worthless.
Mm-hmm.
And it's contempt of Congress when Secretary Geithner is lying about whether or not whistleblowers are made whole at the World Bank.
Now, in a correspondence that you sent out yesterday, you said it is necessary to bring the World Bank's $180 billion in bonds into compliance on the world capital market before permanent backwardation in gold interrupts world commerce. Explain to us what you mean by gold backwardization.
Okay, it is the fact that people don't trust the credibility of the Treasury Department. And so how are their dollars, how can people trust whether or not the dollars are worth anything if they cannot take the word of the U.S. government? And they can't. The government has been caught lying. And after I was fired, three senators asked for a GAO audit, or not an audit. They wanted the GAO to look into corruption at the World Bank. Senators Lugar, Leahy, and Bayh, they asked for this in 2008. And the World Bank stonewalled. So there's something called the International Organization of Supreme Audit Institutions. That group knows everything about the GAO audit not going forward. There's something called the International Organization of Securities Commissioners. That group knows everything about the problems when the Serious Fraud Office called up the SEC and the SEC stonewalled. So what you have is you have people in the country thinking that the United States is a beacon of light. And what you actually have is you have this terrible rot.
Yeah, well, yeah, absolutely. We've seen this over and over again. If we look at the Benghazi situation, that didn't get any traction until whistleblowers came forward. And now it's gotten a lot of traction. Still remains to be seen whether anything is going to be done to reform the government systemically or institutionally. Where do you see this going, this particular scandal? You're finally starting to get some traction, at least in the alternative media. We didn't catch up on the story until just today. And it's just been the last week, I think, that you've started to get some traction in that story. Where do you see this headed?
Actually, I think it's already just about solved, because although I could not get through to the public, I could get through to the state attorneys general, because the states are required to protect bondholders in their states. There's blue sky securities laws. So I got through to the states big time. I got through to the governors, and I also got through to the chief justices of the state Supreme Courts. Because when the Board of Governors settled my suit and the clerk in the Court of Appeals ignored that, I went to the Judicial Conference, which is chaired by the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court. And I told John Roberts that if he didn't start straightening things out, we were going to have a currency war. And I could say this quite accurately, although when I testified in the UK Parliament, that told me that the chances that I was going to break through this conspiracy of silence were excellent. They were like 90%. It was only a question of when. And the fact that the cover-up went to this extent was actually quite helpful, because what it did was it diagnosed the state capture. It diagnosed the fact that the Securities and Exchange Commission was that there were two kinds of investors. The big investors that could do insider trading, including the Federal Reserve, and the little ones who would have to pick up the pieces.
Now, when you talk about state capture, let's pick up on that term, because that's something that actually is beyond crony capitalism. When we think of crony capitalism, we look at it as a particular corporation or institution that is getting special favors from the government. You're talking about the government actually being taken captive by these corrupt organizations.
That's exactly what I'm talking about. And if you go on my website, you will see the letters that I'm writing to the various entities telling them that if you don't report this at this point, that is state capture. When I called it state capture, I don't use that, I'm a lawyer, I don't use that term wildly. This was during the presidential election when you had Barack Obama campaigning against Mitt Romney, who had a lot of money coming in from outside, and Mitt Romney's national security advisor was Robert Zoellick, who the board didn't want to reappoint for a second term as president because of this corruption.
He had been president of the World Bank. Robert Zoellick had been not gotten a second appointment because of corruption, and yet he was Romney's what, financial advisor? What was his position there?
He was the national security transition planning chief, and I asked CBS to have a question during the presidential debate about this corruption, and CBS knew all about the corruption because during the David Letterman interview of Cameron, they raked Cameron over the coals about what had happened to Andrew Mitchell, who was fired as the man in charge of the development aid in the UK, because the UK gave a lot of money, and here was all this corruption at the World Bank, and here was this problem with a serious fraud office getting stonewalled by the SEC. So CBS knew all about the corruption and was able to rake David Cameron over the coals. At one point, what happened with Mitchell was Mitchell, after he was fired, there was something called Plebgate. They were just giving him a terribly hard time in the UK. So here's CBS, who knows exactly what the story is, and yet they're not putting this question during the presidential election when it's so relevant for the choice of who's going to be your president.
Right.
So that's state capture.
Let's kind of wrap this up. Now, where we stand right now, we still don't have any mainstream media covering this yet, but you're getting a lot more exposure in the alternative media. You still haven't had the federal government do any, they're basically ignoring this, and there's not really been any fundamental change in structure with the federal government or with the World Bank. But you feel that things are starting to turn because you have informed at the state level. You've informed attorney generals and courts and that sort of thing as to what's happening. Have they done anything? Okay, tell us about that.
All right. You've seen a number of state militias. This is not an easy thing for the state governors to do. They've been getting national security warning letters, but they're signing this legislation. You see a number of states that are now moving to have the precious metals recognized as legal tender. Utah has done this, and 12 other legislatures are considering this. So, yes, the states are very, and I had a conversation with the states before I went on Coast to Coast to find out, you know, just to let them know that I was going to be talking about these things and that I was having this problem with Eric Holder. And let's get back into the backwardation. This is something that makes me nervous, but also makes me realize that we are going to come to a good, happy resolution. Backwardation is when you don't sell your gold because you're afraid that the paper currency is not going to be worth what your gold was. And we're starting to approach that situation. And if you get into that situation, you don't have a way to finance international trade and the world goes into a meltdown. So I've been warning the governments that the time to correct this problem is now. And I've gone to the Joint Chiefs of Staff about this. That's what I was talking to them. You know, I said, what's your plan here? Do you want to go into gold backwardation? Do you want to go back into the Middle Ages with bartered trade? Is this where you're headed? And they said, are you asking us whether we want to have martial law? I said, no. I said, what I want you to do is I want you to look at what's going on, take a long, hard look at what's going on, and I want you to laugh Eric Holder out of office.
So the first thing they responded to you was, do you want us to have martial law? That's one of the concerns that we've had, is that they're looking at an implosion and that they look at the only way that they're going to get out of this is to basically come down with an iron fist on everybody as everything implodes. You're hoping that perhaps they may go back and reform themselves so that they now have the full faith and credit and they can continue on a paper currency? Is that what you see as a way out of this?
No, no. Okay. I'm really not very interested in what they want to do. Mm-hmm. I think they've shown themselves to be pigs at the trough that are not apt to understand how they're coming across to the rest of the world. They're blind to that. Or they would have seen this coming, and they would have just realized that they had to be subject to law. But there's a very easy way out that has nothing to do with them. And that is for the states themselves. There are all kinds of things the states can do. They can establish state banks if they want. Mm-hmm. In any event,
which we have in North Dakota, I believe, something to that effect.
That's right. There are any number, but the issue is that we are running out of time. Mm-hmm. But what you have is you have all of the countries of the world that understand this, and we're all pulling together. It's a coalition, and it's really quite dramatic and beautiful to see how this. I've gotten a number of phone calls from the embassies that I faxed. If you look at what I've been faxing them, I've been explaining to them about all of the articles that have come out now and these interviews that I'm getting, and they're all quite encouraged. I think the American public is really they're starting to understand that they've got to to hold their government accountable.
As you said, we're running out of time. That's true in our interview, but it's also true for the country as well. And I certainly hope that people wake up and demand that there be a fix. And I agree with you that the best place that we can fix this is outside of Washington, because Washington is just so incredibly corrupt, and we see that over and over again. There appears to be no interest whatsoever from either party to address the systemic corruption that we find there. Instead, they just come after whistleblowers like you. So we hope that things go well on your May 30th court date, and that's in D.C. And do you want to give your website information or any more information about that before we go?
www.kahudes.net. And just one last thing, the federal government, don't forget, they did pass that legislation with a condition on the capital increase that whistleblowers be made whole. So there's, you know, it's not a total throw the baby out with the bathwater.
Good.
There's a baby there.
Yeah. There are some good senators there. Well, thank you very much for talking to us, Karen Hudes. And thank you so much for standing up and doing the right thing and being vocal about it and pressing it. That's, I think, the greatest hope that we've got is that people like you who are on the inside, who see things that are wrong, not only speak up about it, but are persistent and have a backbone when the system turns against them. And you certainly have done that. And you certainly have our gratitude. Thank you very much.
Thanks for having me.
Thank you. Well, it's vitally important that we keep alternative media alive and well. InfoWars certainly a key player in the alternative media. And one of the ways that you can help us is by getting a subscription to Prison Planet TV. Just one subscription will let you share that with up to 10 people simultaneously. So it helps get the information out, the news that is not being covered, as we just talked about, the news that's not being covered by the mainstream media. You know, that vast media conglomerate that's only owned by five different companies. We're very independent, but we depend on your contribution, your support to maintain that independence. Well, that's it for tonight. We'll be back tomorrow at 7 Central, 8 p.m. Eastern.
Many anthropologists and archaeologists believe that before man even discovered the power to harness and use fire, we were involved in agrarian activities. That is, taking the seeds of plants and then replanting them to produce more. The very foundation of our modern civilization and human culture is centered around the planting and cultivation of edible plants, fruits, vegetables, nuts, you name it. And the globalists have been going after gardening. They've been harassing people that have gardens in their front yards or their backyards. They've called for licenses for people to have gardens because you can't trust prisoners in the police state America to be able to grow their own food. That's why I've come to the realization that we need to become self-sufficient. You need to be informed. You need to have the Second Amendment to protect yourself. You need to be politically active to wake up others. You need to filter your water. But you also need to plant a garden. Even if you live in an apartment, you can do this. If you live in the countryside, obviously you can do it on a grand scale. There are so many green belts and areas that humans don't even visit nearby cities and in suburbs where people are now more and more planting their own little private gardens and meadows and off the side of the road. Ladies and gentlemen, it is a revolutionary act to unplug from the television, to unplug from the computer and all the globalist propaganda, and to go out in your backyard or your front yard or planters at your apartment or on the roof of the building where you live and to plant a garden.
Here are some of the amazing deals at InfoWars Seed Center at InfoWarsShop.com. The Survival Seed Vault by My Patriot Supply features only the finest survival heirloom seeds for a robust and hardy garden, even in the toughest of times. The ARC All-in-One Seed Kit contains 70 varieties of 50,000 seeds of fruits, vegetables, medicinal, and culinary herbs. All ARC seeds are heirloom. Each type is labeled and sealed separately for ease of use and longevity. The Deluxe Emergency Seed Bank combines three of Emergency Seed Bank's top sellers: the Family Survival Emergency Seed Bank, the Medicinal Herb Seeds Pack, and the Culinary Herb Seeds Pack. We also have starter varieties of the deluxe seed packages for fruit, salad, salsa, peppers, and medicinal herbs and more. Go to the InfoWars Seed Center at InfoWarsShop.com.
A little seed can grow a huge tree that produces fruit for up to 50 years. We have the best life bombs. That's what these are. We have the best weapons against death out there at the lowest prices, waiting for you to lovingly plant them and lovingly grow them and lovingly eat them and share them with others. We will strike back against the New World Order, and this is only one more initiative in our fight against them. So please join us at InfoWarsShop.com, or you can link through at InfoWars.com at the InfoWars Seed Center.